The Holy Spirit is a person, just as divine as the Father and the Son. You've heard about knowing the heart of Jesus. You've heard about knowing the heart of the Father. Well, today I want to reveal to you the heart of the Holy Spirit. Yes, the Holy Spirit is God. Yes, the Holy Spirit is a person. And yes, I'm going to show you that in Scripture. But then I want to talk to you about the heart of the Holy Spirit and how we can become, in fact, how we need to become people who are sensitive to His voice. That's what we're discussing on this edition of Spirit Church here on Encounter TV. Stephen Moctezuma is here with me as usual. He's going to lead you in worship, and then we're going to get right into this lesson. Here is Stephen Moctezuma. Now, when I talk about the Holy Spirit being a person, please understand that I'm not saying that He is a human being or that He is less divine than the Father and the Son. When I say that the Holy Spirit is a person, I mean that He is a personal being, that He has a will, He has a mind, He has a heart. And because of this, we need to become people who are sensitive to the Holy Spirit. I want to show you here that the Bible refers to the Holy Spirit as a He, as a person. Now, in the case of the original language, the Greek, there are instances where the Holy Spirit is referred to in the masculine pronoun, such as we see in John chapter 15 and John chapter 16. So let me show you those verses. John chapter 15, verse 26. It's one we've read often here on Spirit Church. The Bible says, "But I will send you the Advocate, the Spirit of truth, He will come to you from the Father and will testify all about me." The Bible does not refer to Him as an it. We also see in John chapter 16, verses 13 and 14, "But when He, the Spirit of truth, comes, He will guide you into all the truth. For He will not speak of His own initiative, but whatever He hears, He will speak, and He will disclose to you what is to come. He will glorify me, for He will take of mine and will disclose it to you." Now, not only is the Bible referring to the Holy Spirit as a He, but it is also telling us in this portion of Scripture that the Holy Spirit can speak. He has a voice, and that He does not speak of His own initiative, meaning that it is possible for him to have his own initiative. It's emphasizing that the Holy Spirit is cooperating with the plan of the Father and with the work of the Son. Now, the Bible refers to the Holy Spirit as a who and not a what. 1 John chapter 5, verses 6 through 8 say, "And Jesus Christ was revealed as God's Son by his baptism in water and by shedding his blood on the cross, not by water only, but by water and blood. And the Spirit, who is truth, confirms it with his testimony." So we have these three witnesses, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and all three agree. Now, it's important here that I point out to you that I don't want to just make the case that the Holy Spirit is a person, but that he is a person equal in divinity with the Father and the Son, but distinct as his own person. This is what is referred to as the Trinity. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, each a distinct person of what's called the Godhead, yet equally divine as one another. So first I want to show you that the Holy Spirit is a distinct person separate from the Father and the Son. And then a little bit later, I'm going to show you that the Holy Spirit is equally divine as the Father and the Son. Matthew chapter 3, verses 16 and 17 say this, "After his baptism, as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were open, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. And a voice from heaven said, 'This is my dearly loved Son, who brings me great joy.'" In these two portions of Scripture, we see the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit all present at the same time, distinct from one another. This is actually the first time in the New Testament that all three are mentioned there together. The first time in the Old Testament is, of course, at creation, when God spoke. God the Father spoke the Word, who is the Son, John 1:1 and John 1:14, and the Holy Spirit hovered above the face of the deep, breathing life into that Word and causing creation. So that shows you how they work together. But for now, I'm just pointing out to you the fact that the Bible makes clear distinctions between them. So they're all three mentioned here. They all exist, and they are all distinct. The Bible also says in Romans chapter 8, verses 9 through 11, "However, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to him. If Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, yet the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you." It was the Holy Spirit who raised Christ from the dead. Therefore, he must be distinct from Christ Jesus. Matthew chapter 28, verse 19 says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." Again, all three are mentioned right alongside each other and as distinct persons. So, why does the Bible refer then to the Holy Spirit as the? This is one of the more common questions, and I'm not trying to be condescending, but to me it's really silly because the answer is very simple. Look here at the verse we just read, Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." Jesus is referred to in John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus told him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." The way, the truth, the life, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. The article "the" does not necessarily make something non-personal. The Holy Spirit is a title. He is the Spirit of God. Now, the Scripture has not given us a name by which we call him, but the title is different from the name. So we know that the Holy Spirit can be a person even though he is referred to as the. And if the Holy Spirit can't be a person just because he's called the Holy Spirit, then the same would also apply to the Father and the Son. So we don't question the personal being of Jesus because he's referred to as the way, the truth, the life, the resurrection, the bread of heaven, the rose of Sharon. We can go on and on with his titles. But having a title does not make someone non-personal. The police officer, the president, the teacher, and so forth. Now, the Holy Spirit is distinct from the Father and the Son, and he is a person, as we will continue to prove as we simultaneously prove that he is also divine. Look at this. The Holy Spirit has a will. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 11 says, "But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will." The Holy Spirit can speak. Acts chapter 8, verse 29, "The Holy Spirit said to Philip, 'Go over and walk along beside the carriage.'" The Holy Spirit is referred to as God. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17 says, "Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty." The Holy Spirit is referred to as one with Christ. Acts chapter 16, verses 6 through 7. "They passed through the Phrygian and Galatian region, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. And after they came to Mysia, they were trying to go into Bithynia, and the Spirit of Jesus did not permit them." So within two verses, he's called the Holy Spirit and the Spirit of Jesus. They are one and the same. The Holy Spirit is omniscient or all-knowing. The scripture says in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 10 through 11, "But it was to us that God revealed these things by His Spirit. For His Spirit searches out everything and shows us God's deep secrets. No one can know a person's thoughts except that person's own spirit, and no one can know God's thoughts except God's own spirit." The Holy Spirit knows the mind of God, and therefore He is omniscient. The Holy Spirit is omnipresent. The scripture says in Psalm chapter 139, verse 7, "I can never escape from your spirit. I can never get away from your presence." So there we've seen that the Holy Spirit is personal, distinct from the Father and the Son, and just as divine as the Father and the Son. Now, the scripture gives us these context clues and these truths about each member of the Trinity. Nobody doubts the divinity of the Father. Nobody doubts the divinity of the Son. And now you can no longer doubt the divinity of the Holy Spirit. Now, if each one of these are divine and they are distinct from one another, this automatically proves the doctrine of the Trinity. So the Bible doesn't necessarily refer to the Trinity by name, but we can deduce from looking at the scriptures referring to each member of the Trinity that they are all equally divine, yet distinct from one another. So just a little analogy to help you understand this. Now, this may help some and this may confuse others, but I know it helped me. I wish I came up with it, but I heard this illustration used. It would be like trying to explain a three-dimensional object, such as a cube with six sides, to somebody who lives in a world that's only two-dimensional. To someone who lives in a two-dimensional world where the third dimension does not exist, a cube with six sides would appear in their dimension as only a square, revealing one side at a time. Now, the person who lives in that two-dimensional world would say, "I see six different sides appear at different times." Yet, if I were to tell that person who lives in that two-dimensional world that all six sides are a part of one cube, they would have trouble understanding that. In the same way, because God dwells in a heavenly dimension, there may be things beyond our understanding. This is not illogical. It just means that there are some things beyond our understanding, such as a cube is not necessarily illogical just because someone is limited to the second dimension. Now, again, that may help some, it may confuse some. If it didn't help you, just disregard it. To others, that may have helped. But look it up. It's a great analogy. I've heard it used several times. Now, even if the Holy Spirit is personal and divine, isn't seeking His attention or friendship wrong? Some people have this guilt. They feel like they're doing something wrong when they seek the attention or the friendship of the Holy Spirit. But the scripture says here in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 14, "May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all." Now look at that. "And the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all." That word fellowship in the Greek is koinonia, which has to do with relationship or friendship or connection. In the same way that we are to fellowship with Jesus, we are also to fellowship with the Holy Spirit, or have a friendship with the Holy Spirit. In fact, it is that friendship with the Holy Spirit that makes up the entirety of the success of your spirituality. It is the Holy Spirit who glorifies the Son, who reveals the Word, who inspires you to truly worship, who draws you into the depths of prayer, who cultivates the love of God within your heart, and who gives you the power to witness and perform the miraculous. It is the Holy Spirit who is Himself the key to living the Christian life. Jesus was anointed with the Holy Spirit, and just as Jesus was anointed with the Holy Spirit, so are you anointed with the Holy Spirit. Everything that Jesus did for others while here in the earth in physical form, the Holy Spirit will do for you today if you'll just have faith. Now, He is a person, a distinct person of the Trinity, just as divine as the Father and the Son. So this scripture stands out to me. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. "And do not bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way you live. Remember, He has identified you as His own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption." Don't grieve the Holy Spirit. I'll never forget the first time that I found that the Holy Spirit could be my friend, that I could have a personal friendship with the Holy Spirit, was through a book called Good Morning, Holy Spirit, written by Pastor Benny Hinn. And Pastor Benny's ministry has been a heavy influence on my life, as many of you are able to tell. I, of course, am my own distinct person. I'm not called to be the next anyone. I'm called to be the first me. I'm Diga Hernandez, and I'm going to embrace that. However, there are some things that have been imparted into my life that I can't deny. And that book, Good Morning, Holy Spirit, completely transformed the way I looked at the Holy Spirit. Before then, I thought that praying to Him or talking to Him was maybe some form of misdemeanor idolatry, or that God looked angrily upon that type of praying. But I found that through that book that that was not the case, that in fact I could know Him. And Pastor Benny talked about a woman by the name of Catherine Coleman, who has also influenced my life through her teachings that I see on YouTube, and I listen to things by her all the time. And, you know, she said something that Pastor Benny wrote about in his book. She, before thousands of people at a miracle service, she's preaching, worshiping, and suddenly she just begins to weep. And she says, "Please don't grieve the Holy Spirit. He's all I have." She had such a heart for the Holy Spirit that it broke her to know that His heart could be broken. Because the Holy Spirit is a person, He does have a mind of His own, but He also has a heart of His own. The Bible tells us here that He can be grieved. My worst fear is not that I would lose my life, not that I would be assaulted demonically, not that people's opinions about me would change. My worst fear is that I would grieve the Holy Spirit, because I so cherish His friendship. I cherish that presence that's on my life. I would want nothing to do with anything that would disrupt the flow of the Holy Spirit in my life. And so the scripture tells us in Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 15, "Catch all the foxes, those little foxes, before they ruin the vineyard of love, for the grapevines are blossoming." This is talking about putting an end to those things that can bring destruction, putting an end to those things that grieve the Holy Spirit, putting an end to those things that can ruin love. And they're just little things. The Bible refers to them as those little foxes, but it is the little fox that can spoil the vine. Those seemingly insignificant sinful habits, those subtle fleshly mindsets that we allow to rise within ourselves. These are the things that grieve him. And these are the things that break his heart. The Bible tells us in Genesis that God was greatly grieved. And he said, my spirit will not strive with man forever. He couldn't take the pain that their sin was causing him. So I want to say to you, don't grieve the Holy Spirit. I think of Samson, who was so empowered by the Holy Spirit that he experienced supernatural strength. And maybe I'll do a whole lesson on him one day. But what stood out to me in the scripture was in Judges chapter 16, verse 20, where the scripture tells us that Samson went out to fight the Philistines as he had before. But because of what he had given up, because of what he had compromised, he knew not that the Holy Spirit had left him. I've heard it said that the Holy Spirit is the only one who will fire you and not tell you you've been fired. That the Holy Spirit leaves quietly. You know, when a demonic being comes on someone, comes onto their life quietly, but when it comes out, it leaves loudly. When the Holy Spirit comes on a life, he comes on loudly. It's the baptism of the Holy Ghost. But he leaves quietly. Now, I know there are those who are watching this who are saying, Brother David, that's Old Testament. The Holy Spirit does not leave the believer. Well, okay, let's put aside our doctrinal differences to agree upon this one thing. The Holy Spirit can be stifled. The Holy Spirit can be obstructed from working in your life, and the Holy Spirit can be grieved. Whatever you may believe about the presence of the Holy Spirit, whether you believe he can never leave the believer or whether you believe he can leave the believer, it's irrelevant. The point is, how does it apply to your life, and how does this play out in our Christianity? How does this play out in the way we live? The Holy Spirit can be grieved. His work can be stifled. We must know his word. We must know his voice, and we must obey his word and his voice. Being sensitive to the Holy Spirit is not just about how clearly you can hear him, but about how quickly you respond when he speaks. I'm going to say that again. Being sensitive to the Holy Spirit is not just about how clearly you hear him, but about how quickly you respond when he speaks. Delay is disobedience. Compromise is disobedience. What is in your life that grieves the Holy Spirit? What things do you watch? What things do you hear? In what do you participate that reminds the Holy Spirit of things that break his heart? The Holy Spirit can be grieved. I think of Ananias and Sapphira. Acts chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. They lied to the Holy Spirit. And this is New Testament, guys. They lied to the Holy Spirit and they dropped dead. These were believers. So that will mess with your paradigm. Let that mess up your theology. Yes, he's gentle. Yes, he's kind. The Holy Spirit is patient, working with us. He teaches us. He comforts us. He speaks to us. He instructs us. He reveals truth. You have to be very patient to do that for someone like us. And the Holy Spirit is patient. He is gentle. The Holy Spirit does not make you senseless and silly. He makes you sharp. He is not wild and irreverent and bizarre and wacky and weird. The Holy Spirit is elegant and royal. He's majestic and regal. He is a gentleman. He is classy. And he will work with you. But he's also very vulnerable to you. He's very vulnerable. Yes, he can be pleased by the actions that you decide to take. but he can also be grieved. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit. If you have grieved the Holy Spirit, you might find that this portion of Scripture is inspiring. Psalm chapter 51, verses 1 through 12. If you have, let me tell you something. He's merciful. Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 through 23 say, "The faithful love of the Lord never ends. His mercies never cease. Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each morning." Now back to Psalm chapter 51, verses 1 through 12. The scripture says, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness. According unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, thee only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest and be clear when thou judgest. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins, and blot out all mine iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit." We all do things that grieve the Holy Spirit. That is no reason to accept them in our lives. The Holy Spirit is a person, just as divine as the Father and Son, perfectly distinct, but equally divine. He has a mind, he has a will, he has a heart, and he can be grieved. Let's be careful not to grieve our friend. I'm not talking about living in paranoia. I'm not talking about living under a religious system that has you constantly criticizing yourself and beating yourself up for the sins that you commit. No, I'm talking about living with a love for the Holy Spirit and enjoying that fellowship with him to the point that we are aware of him, that we are sensitive of his desires, that we love what he loves and hate what he hates. I want to be sensitive to him. I want to consider him, not just when I pray, not just when I read the word, not just when I go to church, not just when I watch videos like these. I want to consider him every moment of every day. I want that fellowship, and I don't want that fellowship to be broken. I want a friendship with him. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit. Let's pray now. First, we're going to pray that God would forgive us for those times that we have grieved the Holy Spirit. And then we're going to pray that we become people who experience the joy of God's forgiveness and a new, fresh walk with him. I know you want that. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for that one who desires to be made clean. Let them feel your forgiveness and love. Lord, despite what they feel, despite what they think, despite what the enemy says to them and how the enemy accuses them, I pray in Jesus' name that as they repent before you now, that they would experience the joy of their salvation. Lord, break off the bondages of guilt and shame. And help us, Father, to be sensitive to your voice. help us to consider our precious friend, the Holy Spirit, who is gentle and kind, yet powerful. Help us to consider his heart. Help us to be people who please him and not grieve him. And I pray in Jesus' name that we would experience a closer fellowship with the person of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. And I want you to say it. If you agree, say amen. Well, that does it for the lesson. I pray that blessed you. I want to welcome now the new members of Spirit Church. There you are up on the screen. We love you and we are praying for you. I always say that because I always mean it. Look at those names from all over the world. We're excited that you've joined. Now, if you want information on how you can join the Spirit family, how you can join Spirit Church, then go ahead and click on the link that's just about to appear over my head. If you're not watching this on YouTube, that means that you're going to have to use the information at the bottom of the screen to manually become a member of Spirit Church. Now, I want to read your comments. These are comments from the video, A Fresh Anointing, which was the last teaching that I did. Anne writes, I can't tell you how excited I am that I found your videos. I have such a hunger for the Lord. I spend my days constantly talking, praising, and speaking in tongues. Jesus is truly an amazing God. I am so grateful for him. Thank you for allowing him to speak through you. These videos are a blessing. Well, Anne, thank you for writing into me. I am glad that the videos are blessing you, and I pray that the presence and power of the Holy Spirit are transforming you as you enjoy our ministry content. Shania January writes, thank you, Minister David. This message was for me. God showed me I needed fresh anointing. I have been pressing for the new oil. Everything you said I did at one point, and I stopped allowing it to be my first fruit to the Lord. You have confirmed what I need to do. Thank you very much for sharing Kingdom Truth. And thank you for watching. If you are wondering what she's talking about, A Fresh Anointing is a challenging message. It will help you get out of that dry place. It will help you come out of that monotony and that apathy, but it will also challenge you at the same time. Reina Jingyun writes, I didn't realize that I was running out of oil in my spiritual life. No wonder I always felt dry. I thought I was still on fire, but I was slowly fading. Thank God. Thank God is right. Thank God that he revealed that truth to you and helped you to discover the fresh oil. Rebecca Miguel writes, the Holy Spirit amazes me through you. Well, I do hope that it's through me because it is definitely not coming from me. The Holy Spirit, I'm so thankful to him because it's his presence, it's his power. That's why you're set free watching these videos. That's why people are healed watching these videos. That's why people experience the power and the presence at the miracle service that they come to for our ministry. All the healings, all of the salvations, all of the testimonies, all of the experiences, it's because of the Holy Spirit. His presence and his power at our events and on our content, that is what makes this ministry unique. The way it manifests tangibly, where people can sense it, I'm beyond grateful for that. And I thank the Holy Spirit for doing that. And I thank the Holy Spirit for touching your life, Rebecca. Ralph writes, Pastor David, I really needed this message because I was thinking the Holy Spirit had left me. But after listening to the message, you spoke directly to me. Also, the prophetic word about the minister seeking where to move next in ministry was me too. God bless you. Well, brother, I am so glad that the Holy Spirit spoke to you. And that's one of the things we allow God to do on this broadcast. We don't stifle the Holy Spirit. I like to give words of knowledge as the Holy Spirit leads me on the program. So keep watching. Maybe God will speak to you through a prophetic word of knowledge one of these days. So that does it for the comments. Now, if you would like me to read your comment, go ahead and leave a comment below. My staff will go through it, send the best ones over. And when I say best ones, I mean the ones that pertain most to the lesson. They're short enough for me to read. And you know what I would actually like you guys to start doing right now? If you could leave me not only your name, but also your country or your city, where you're writing from, so that we can put that on your comments. I'd like to know where all of these comments are coming from. And we so appreciate every comment, but as you know, not every comment could make it on here. Now, don't turn off the video just yet. I want to update you on some things. We are getting closer than ever, and I'm so excited because it means we can win more souls for the kingdom. He who wins souls is wise, the Bible says. Now, I want to take an offering, but let me tell you why I take offerings that are on our broadcast. We take offerings because it helps to fund our mandate. Now, there are those who say, well, Brother David, if it was really the Lord, you wouldn't have to take an offering and people would just give it to you. That's just silly. The Bible says you have not because you ask not. And most people want to know what's going on in the ministry. And I know you, the believer. You don't have to be manipulated. You don't have to be pressured. You don't have to be coaxed into giving. You just want to know that your support is going to the gospel. And if it's going to the gospel, I know that you're all for it. And so I want to tell you that we're winning souls, that we are out there and we are preaching the uncompromised gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, this ministry is doing a couple things. We are winning the lost and we are building the believer through three distinct operations of ministry: worldwide television, international events, and global discipleship media. So the worldwide television, Encounter TV, airs on several networks all around the world. We're available in over 100 million homes worldwide. The international events, these are our miracle services where we evangelize, we pray for the sick, and the power of God moves in a very special way. You have to get out to one of those events eventually. And then, of course, worldwide or global discipleship media. And that is how we build the believer. So it's a two-edged sword. We win souls, we build the believer. And in fact, as we're building the believer, we're actually indirectly winning souls because the believers we build become Jesus-loving, Spirit-filled, uncompromised, Holy Ghost, gospel-preaching lovers of souls, and they go out and they start winning people. And so we're doing that, and it's all very simplified through those three distinct ministries. Now, we are raising $30 a month support. Sign up to become a $30 a month partner. Help us get to this next phase of expansion. We're almost there. Here's where we are in our progress. When we first started the campaign, it was a rush of partners, and now we're still growing, but that has come to a plateau, but that doesn't mean it has stopped. But if you're wondering why it started so fast in the beginning and then it's starting to slow down, that's because when we first announced it, all those who were already watching us jumped on board, or most of them, I should say. And now we're giving people time to come on. They're praying about it. Some people are getting jobs. Some people are setting their finances in order. But every week we are growing. Now, here's what we're going to do with that expansion of ministry. Listen to me. I'm almost done. Just hear me out just for a couple more minutes. That expansion of ministry, we're going to build a new ministry center where we're going to hold weekly meetings on Sunday nights. Well, that's the day we have planned for now. It may change, but the concept is weekly meetings where we teach the Bible, where you can come in and you can come in live, and we're going to broadcast those live. We're going to start weekly meetings. We're going to have a 24/7 prayer room. We're going to launch an internet network that's going to go on top box TV sets, such as Amazon Fire, Roku, Apple TV, Google Chromecast. That's the future of television. I'm telling you, we're going to reach millions that way. And then on top of that, here's what I'm most excited about. I love that we're getting a new facility. We're going to bring in studio audiences. And I love that we're going to reach more people through media than ever before. What I'm really excited about is that when we get to that next phase of ministry, this means we can do more events and on larger scales in more locations. So I have it in my mind, I want to go to a different state every single month and a couple countries a year. But we need support to do that. And after we finish this campaign, guess what? I'm going to ask for even more support so that we can continue to grow. So this never stops. Our job is never done. We just like to set markers to inspire people to go. So help us out. Send me as your ambassador to the nations. Listen, we're going to win millions to Jesus. You're going to see a day that we are packing stadiums filled with thousands who give their lives to Jesus. I want the crowds to come because I want to win the masses to Jesus. And you can help us do it. You can get in on the ground level. You can say, Lord, I'm going to be a part of this ministry, and I want to be there from the beginning. You can say you were there from the beginning when we're reaching millions. And let me tell you something. It's not impossible. We're going to do it. It's going to happen, and you get to be a part of it. So go ahead. Become a monthly ministry partner. If you can't sign up for a monthly gift, that's fine. Make a one-time donation. That also helps. So whether you're giving a one-time or monthly donation, go ahead and do that now. I thank you for your generosity. Thank you for helping me win souls. That's why we do it. I'm telling you, the gospel is the most powerful way to transform our world. It's bigger than us. It's about souls. ask yourself, how much is a soul worth to you? Well, that is it for this edition of Spirit Church. Until next time, remember, nothing is impossible with God.
Hey, what's up, guys? Thank you so much for watching Encounter TV. My name is Stephen Moctezuma, and I want to encourage each and every one of you to subscribe to Encounter TV. Encounter TV features hundreds of videos that will help you draw closer to the Lord. We feature worship, miracles, teachings, and so much more. Encounter TV, experience the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit.